Commissioner, so hopefully you recognize me. Thank you so much for having me and welcoming me into your Palm Beach County Creative Community, and special thanks to Nicole and Julia for all of your help and support. I am a freelance travel writer and copywriter, and I'm not very comfortable speaking in front of big crowds. I like to hide behind a computer, but I'm going to be brave, and thank you for letting me share my story with you. So this is where I live. This is Vieques, Puerto Rico, just to put it into context, because obviously after the hurricanes, we took a hit, but this is where I live. The first day I went there on vacation, I was hooked. And that happens to a lot of people with this island. If any of you have ever been there, you would know what I mean. I obviously love to travel, but nowhere has ever touched me immediately the way that this place touched me. And as, this is just everywhere you look, this is what it looks like. So it's incredibly unique and special. The island has not one traffic light or shopping center, and horses roam free everywhere. And if there's traffic, in which maybe needs four cars, this is usually why. So very different place, and I moved from cities, so this was a departure. So Vieques, there it is. It sits about 7 miles to the east of mainland Puerto Rico. It's about 21 by 4 miles, and you can only get there by a puddle jumper plane or a ferry from the main island. There are more than 20 of the most beautiful beaches that you will ever see, and there's a good chance that you will have a beach to yourself if you go there. So we snorkel with turtles, we catch lobsters and cook them on the beach minutes later. It's a wonderful life. And we also have the brightest bioluminescent day in the world, where these little microorganisms called dinoflagellates glow, make the water glow bright blue like that at night. And I know it's science, but it feels like magic. But even with all of these surroundings that are so beautiful, what really stands out to me about Vieques is the people and the community. So it's mostly a mix of native Viequenses, Puerto Ricans from the main island, and North American transplants who decided to make the decision to give up things like Walmart and Chinese food delivery to live a simpler and in many ways more challenging way of life. And it's a place that people are proud of. They're proud to be from there, they're proud to have moved there and live there, and it's a very special community. And just to give you an example, this is a photo from a wedding on the island. Couple that owns a restaurant, and it was just open call, come to the wedding, bring your beach chair, bring coolers, skiers, and just celebrate. So that's what it's like, to give you some context. On an island off of an island, you really need your community. And I wanted to talk about that because this is a problem. So you need each other and you help each other. And if my car breaks down, I can call 20 different people that will come and help me. Restaurants loan each other ingredients if they run out. And people work together, and if you ever go there, you might hear a local say something like, we're all here because we're not all there. And Vieques gave us all a home. So my first trip was purely vacation, and I said I was hooked. I visited 4 more times in the next 2 years, and it would be sometimes for a few days, sometimes for a few weeks, but I kept going back. And at home, which was Philadelphia at the time, people would ask me, why don't you live there? You always talk about this island, why don't you live there? And at the time, I didn't really have anything tying me anywhere. I could be anywhere. And so I figured, you know what? I don't really have an answer for that. And I would always go to islands and say, I wish I could live there. At that point in my life, I was done wishing. I was ready for doing. And so and my job, I mean, why wouldn't you work there? I can work anywhere where there's internet and power. So why wouldn't I want to work there? So on June 18th, 2016, I packed up the dog and my bags and we moved to Vieques. So I went there knowing I would write for the Vieques Insider, which is our local tourism magazine. And I used my profession as a way to integrate myself into the community. So I went horseback riding on the beach and I wrote about it. I went took an intro scuba class and wrote about it. I interviewed 16 chefs on the island and wrote about them. So people started to know me and recognize my work and come up to me with topics for articles. And I was proud to be known as Writer Amy. And that's how everyone has nicknames there. And after hearing some of the other nicknames given to people, Writer Amy felt like a gift. So I've been in Puerto Rico for about 15 months before Hurricane Irma and then Hurricane Maria hit. And before this year, Vieques hadn't been seriously impacted by a hurricane since Hugo in 1989. So everyone says, oh, what did you expect? But it really was very unexpected. And September 6th, Hurricane Irma hit Vieques and Puerto Rico about a week before it hit here. So that's what we saw coming for us. Very scary. We were definitely didn't know what to expect, but it was a miracle that except for a few downed trees and power lines, we really didn't suffer much damage. It still looked like this. That was a couple days later. And our nearby neighbors in the U.S. Virgin Islands and the British Virgin Islands, they were not as lucky. Their islands were destroyed. And in Vieques, we'd all stocked up on water and ramen and Chef Boyardee and all these supplies, and our ferries started running pretty soon after because we really didn't need them. So my friend Christian has a plane, and many of us donated our supplies to him, and he would fly them over to Portola and then fly people back to get out. And we just knew that they were in need of help. We didn't know that 2 weeks later Maria would hit and we'd need all that stuff. We just knew that our neighbors needed help and we were in a position to give it. And that's the kind of place that Vieques is. It's a place of people with big hearts who know how to get things done. So although the damage to the island was minimal, Irma left many parts of Vieques without power for 10 days. And some of you may have experienced living that way after Hurricane Irma as well. It's exhausting. No power means no refrigeration, no fans, no air conditioning, no lights, no washing machine, no hot water. We were all dirty and sweaty and damp, and many people had no running water at all. And we'd gather at the few restaurants that had generators, and we'd charge our phones, and we would eat and drink and laugh and try and feel normal. And like I said, Vieques doesn't have much in terms of fancy amenities, but we have community, and that was the most invaluable resource during that time. But then, we finally got power just in time to prep for Hurricane Maria, which arrived 3 days later. And by that time, we were so worn out, but, and also, because of the power outage, a lot of people hadn't worked in 2 weeks, but didn't have money, but we had no choice, and we stocked up on ramen and beans and Chef Boyardee and batteries and gas and all the things that we had just given away, and we boarded up our houses again. And so Vieques is home to a lot of boat captains who are experts at following the weather, and they all seem to agree that Maria was going to hit us dead on and it was going to be bad. And at that point, it was too late to leave. There were no ferries running anymore. There were no planes running anymore. Anything that was there was what we were going to have until ferry service resumed, and no one knew when that would be. So it was scary. So these are the people that I holed up with during the hurricane. It was Tuesday, September 19th. This was taken after we reunited in Florida. It did not look that clean at the time. So my apartment was hurricane headquarters for us and two dogs. It's not a big place, but it's made of steel and concrete, and we knew it would be safe. So we stayed there, and the first bands of rain started to come in during the day, and the power went out at about noon. The municipality shut off the power, and we just waited. And it already felt very different than Irma, and we just did our best to laugh and keep each other calm and make the best of it. And the sun went down, and the winds picked up. And this is just a funny picture of my friend's horse that she brought in during the storm. I just love that. So the eye of the storm passed directly over Vieques at about 3 a.m. on September 20th, and it brought an intense air pressure that made our ears pop. We didn't expect things like that, and it was pitch black outside. And you just heard, it sounded like a freight train speeding past the window for hours and hours, and we would hear roofs being ripped off and trees falling down, and you just couldn't see anything. And we later learned that we had sustained gusts. We had gusts of about 255 miles per hour, and sustained winds of about 160 miles an hour. So we didn't know what would happen. We heard these trees falling, and we thought, all right, if one tree falls and blocks our way, we all had machetes ready to go, hack our way out. It's a very different way of life. So in the morning, this is what we woke up to. I don't know if you can see it that well, but it went from green, green, green to brown. And this is overnight. So we went to sleep one way, and we woke up to a completely different island. There was not one leaf left on a tree, the trees that were still standing. And we stepped around power lines and branches and pieces of homes to try and see what had happened. And any structure that wasn't made of concrete was, didn't stand a chance. So just to give you some examples, so this is my next door neighbor's house. His name's Augustine. He's an elderly Via Kenze man. We chat all the time, and he leaves me mangoes on my car from his tree. And every day for a year, I have watched him build this addition to his house with his own hands. And we knew he had gone to the hurricane shelter during the storm, which is big enough to house 300 of the 9,000 people on the island. And so we knew he was safe, but we heard his house getting ripped apart, and it was heartbreaking. And we woke up the next morning, and no roof anymore, no windows, pieces strewn across the lawn like trash, and it was just heartbreaking. This is a house across the street from me. It's a container house, you know those container houses from shipping containers? It ripped off into the foundation, over the fence, on its side. Everything spilled out in the street. One more roll and it would have been on my roof. And we heard that at 3 in the morning. We didn't know what it was, but we knew we heard something, and that's what we heard. So all of this overnight. So just to give you some context, this became this. This became that. This, one of our favorite murals, got. So it was a very intense experience. So Maria left many of us with, or left all of us rather, without water, running water, power, gasoline, Wi-Fi, and cell service. I often use the word primitive to describe Vieques, and just give you some pictures of what it looked like. But I use the word lovingly primitive. But after this, primitive took on a new meaning. And our days revolved around trying to get any information about what was happening, making sure that we had done everything we needed to do before the sun went down and it was completely black again. And you think about how many times a day you just pick up your phone to check something, or turn on a light switch, or use the air conditioning, or wash your hands, flush a toilet. I mean, these are things that were completely gone over. And I would say the two scariest things were not having access to gasoline and not having communication. So we were hesitant to drive anywhere because we didn't know when more gas would come, and everyone was using it for generators if we were lucky to have one. And we had no cell phone or Wi-Fi reception. So we didn't know what was going on in the rest of the world. We had no clue what was happening, or even on the other side of the island. We had no way to tell our families that we were alive, and we couldn't access credit cards or your bank, so you could be a millionaire and it didn't matter. All you had was the cash in your pocket, and whatever you could buy with that was all you could get. So we would see planes like this, and planes and helicopters flying by, and they didn't land, and we didn't know why. And we saw a radar plane flying by, and we thought, is there another storm coming? We have no idea. We have no way to know. Do we need to board up our houses? It was a surreal experience. And we would drive down streets we'd driven down 1,000 times, and we did not recognize where we were. Everything looked different. They were covered in debris, and there were houses that were completely obscured before by trees, and suddenly they're out in the open. And like I said, anything that wasn't made of concrete was pretty much leveled. And it was eerie and strange, and we just walked around like zombies, kind of unable to comprehend the full depth of the damage to our island that we love. So that day, after we were walking around, we got back to my apartment, and this dog was waiting there. And it was the sweetest little dog, and it had a collar but no tags, and clearly it was the dog that was loved and had gotten lost in the storm. And we brought her in, and we fed her, and she just seemed so relieved to have a place to stay. And she had little wrinkles on the side of her face, so we named her Abuela, which means grandma in Spanish. And we picked her up, and we walked around, you know, under and over tree branches, trying to see if anyone in the neighborhood recognized her, and no one did. So we held on to her for a little while. So through word of mouth, we learned that there would be meetings like this in the plaza where you could get information about what was going on. And one resident asked about hurt and dead animals, and the man leading the meeting, Jay, he said, I understand, my dog's been missing since the storm, and it hit me, he lives near me. So I went up to him, I showed him a picture of a whale, and I said, is this your dog? And he said, yes. And I said, I have her. And everyone just started clapping and cheering. And it was just such a phenomenal moment, just one win in such a dark time. So September 25th is a day that everything changed for me. I started my day in the dark at 5 a.m. waiting on the gas line after our curfew ended. And at 8:30 a.m., I just couldn't wait there anymore. And I just had to do something. And so I heard, again, everything was you're hearing this and hearing that. And my friend Christian, the one who flew our supplies to Tortola, I had heard that he was flying people to San Juan to try and get out. And I had heard that there was cell phone service in San Juan. So against the warnings of many people on the line, I gave up my spot in the gas line and I drove to the airport hoping he would be there, and he was. And I said, will you take me to San Juan just to try and make a phone call? And he said, come on, let's go. So we went, and the first time I cried after Hurricane Maria was when I saw bars on my cell phone. I had checked it 1,000 times and kept seeing no service, no service, no service. And in the plane, woman next to me elbows me and points to the phone, and I see service, and I just started crying. It was the first ray of hope that something could happen, that, you know, no one was coming to help us, and we didn't know why and what was going on. So we got to San Juan, and I called my parents, and I called a friend, Katie, who lives in Vieques, but was in the States at the time, and I said, is anyone coming to help us? We're alive, we're here. And she said, no one else is, but we got a plane, a private plane, that is en route right now directly to Vieques, and it's coming with our friend Becker is on the plane. He's bringing satellite phones so we can figure out what's going on, and he's bringing medical supplies, and he's gonna evac out some people that need medical help. And that was, I was so happy because something was happening. Someone was coming and some help was coming. So we were flying back to Vieques, and thank goodness I did not put my phone on airplane mode, because I got a text from Katie saying, someone just gave up their seat on that plane. You're the only person we can reach. If you can get back and get your dog and get to the airport before the plane leaves, you can have that seat. So I did. I rushed back. I threw my 30 clothes in a bag. The pilot said you cannot take a lot. I grabbed the dog. I rushed back to the airport and got on that plane. And when I drove by, the gas lines had not moved. No gas had come. Everyone was still sitting there. And this was us after we got off the plane. And just by chance, that plane, I didn't care where it was going, but it happened to be going to Fort Lauderdale. My parents happened to have retired to Boynton Beach 2 weeks before. So I called them when we refueled in San Juan, and I said, text me your address for the Uber. I'm going to be home tonight. And they couldn't believe it. So I spent, this is what people were posting in case someone took a picture that could get out. And I spent my first 36 hours in the States responding to people on Facebook who had posted, does anyone know if my sister's alive, my mother, my brother? And I was one of the only people that had left. It was 6 days later. And so I was the only person that could tell them, yes. And so I just spent 36 hours saying, yes, I saw Tisha, she's okay. She said she's gonna replant her garden so people can have vegetables in 45 days. Or I saw Bill and Scott, they're okay. They waved to me and yelled, I love you, from their friend's pickup truck when they drove by. Or I saw Janelle, she's okay. She was wearing all neon because people needed something cheerful to look at. I was just grateful to be able to do that. So the group of friends whose plane that I got on had formed an organization called Vieques Love. My friend Kelly, who's also my editor at the Vieques Insider, she was in the States at the time too, and the night of the storm, she started this GoFundMe with a goal of raising $50,000 to help pay bills. And 6 days later, by the time I had called her, they had more than $350,000 raised. And as of today, more than 7,200 people have donated more than $900,000 in amounts ranging from $20 to $10,000. An outpouring of love and concern for this little island in the middle of nowhere has been overwhelming and heartwarming. And the money was initially supposed to be used to rebuild, but when they saw no other help was coming, they said, all right, we gotta switch gears and get help now. And so that plane that came with the satellite phones, they were able to set up call centers on the north side and the south side of the island so that people could call and save their families on the line and try to make arrangements on these 30-second phone calls. And, you know, talk about context. These people are lawyers and magazine editors and event planners. They're not FEMA, and we were had to act as FEMA in those few days. So about 7,000 calls were made, and it was a literal lifeline. So when I first got back, I focused about 100% of my time those first few weeks to get help. You know, I felt incredibly lucky to get out, and I felt a big responsibility to the people who were left behind. And so I wrote articles, and I did an interview with People.com, and I was on CBS Radio, and these are, like I said, I don't like this stuff, but it was my responsibility to do that. I had to tell people, these people, there's 9,000 Americans stranded here that need help. So a friend connected me with her friend who was a producer at CNN, and I got them to go to Vieques, and I cried when this story aired. I cried because I was so happy to see my friends' faces, and I cried because they were suffering so much. And I cried because I was able to help bring international attention to my little island, and after that, more news outlets came, and Vieques became a part of the conversation when people talked about what was happening in Puerto Rico. And that was the first time I felt validated for having left, that I had really done more good than I could have done if I had stayed. The second time I felt validated was when I learned that a group of 16 high-profile Democratic senators like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders had written a letter to the president requesting special aid for Vieques and Culebra, another small island. And in it, they quoted an article that I wrote in the Washington Post. And I couldn't believe it. And I didn't know if the president would really care or listen, but I knew these people were listening, and that someone who was influential was listening, and that was a huge moment. So how did I get here today? My friend Jenny, who I've known for 25 years, she lives in Boca, and she connected me with Nicole and Yulia about talking here. And since then, I've been thinking a lot about context. So context, this is what the stores looked like when they finally opened after Maria. So I'm in Super Target here in Boynton Beach a couple weeks later, and the woman in the line next to me in the aisle is like, can you believe they don't have pineapple juice? It's ridiculous. And the other one's like, if I want Boar's Head cold cuts, I have to go to Publix. Can you believe that? And I'm just looking at them, and I'm thinking, this food in this store alone could feed my whole island for a month. And it was just mind-boggling to me, you know, to put that into context. So just some context as well. So when Hurricane Irma was making its way here to the United States, the US News seemed very happy to report that it would hit land before Florida, and so it would lose some strength. So that was good for everyone. Well, not everyone, because the land was Puerto Rico. And so we felt very forgotten and marginalized and demeaned and unimportant and like we didn't matter. And so when the Washington Post contacted me, to write about Maria before the storm, I said, listen, this is what happened, and people, you know, it wasn't right, and my editor said, I was part of the problem, I'm not gonna let that happen again, we want you guys heard. And that was an amazing moment, too. There's one of the articles that wrote for the Washington Post. So when you tell people you live on Vieques, a lot of the times they say, what's that? What the hell is that? And so part of the challenge was first letting people know this is an island that exists, and second, there's 9,000 Americans there that need help. So it was a challenge to put that into context for people. And just one thing I want to say about context, my friend wrote this post yesterday on Facebook, and I think it says it better than I do. So to my loved ones, as you go about your day today and carry on the normal hustle and bustle of your life, I humbly ask that you stop for a moment or two and envision your life without electricity. As of today, much of Vieques, Puerto Rico, USA has been without power for 100 days. 100 days. Many people haven't seen power in their homes since Hurricane Irma. Not Maria, Irma. Let that sink in. 100 days in the dark. Do you realize all the ways in which electricity literally fuels your lives? It's more than hot showers and homework by candlelight and access to a working coffee pot. Sanitation systems operate with electricity. Water filtration systems that bring clean water to your home, electricity. Cell phone and communication towers, electricity. Gas pumps, power, life-saving equipment like oxygen pumps and asthma treatments and dialysis, you guessed it, electricity. Imagine this being your life, taking care of your kids, your home, and heading to work every day like this. In most cases, you can cross the work part out because lots of businesses can't operate in these circumstances. Sound fun? This isn't a Republican issue or a Democratic issue. It's not political or religious. It's not about a foreign country. This is a humanitarian issue happening right here in your backyard in the good old US of A. If you're not outraged, it's time to wake up. So I think she said it better than I could. So just to wrap up, I just want to say, so I went back to visit this past weekend to see when I can go back. And this is what it looks like now. It's green, green, green. I was so happy to see that. And so people are helping each other. I mean, this was just seeing my friends and, you know, you're together 24/7 and then you can't even talk to them on the phone. So it was so good to see everybody. And people are helping each other. You know, they're not getting the help they need from every level of government. And so they're helping each other and doing beach cleanups and bringing coolers and things to people who need to keep medical equipment cold and feeding the island. Jose Andres set up a World Central Kitchen there. So people are making the best of it. And there's a very, very long way to go, but we've come a long way.